Rule about worship number one. Do not make jokes right before walking on stage. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Yeah? Doing okay? Come on, let's stand and worship together if we can. Or just stand and all laugh. One of you. Let's all have a good laugh. It's good to be alive today. Amen? Yeah. Did anybody else feel like yesterday was the longest day of the year? Anybody else?
Yeah.
Just about. Father, but just to be alive. Father, a chance to be forgiven. chance to walk through this life having an understanding of actually, you say we won't understand it. Father, to have that peace, that's that, the surpassing of understanding. Father, we're just so grateful. I just praise you for this morning, Father. Let us worship you in a way today, God, that expresses that, that shows you how we preach you.
Surround me with God's people said.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, guys. Appreciate that so much. You know, I think about that song. I
heard that song played on a few years ago. And it's not a message. Think about God's done. I know the skeletons in my closet. Thank God that He cleaned them out the moment I got saved. Amen?
Yeah.
So thank you for that. Hey, listen, we'll go over the announcements at the end of the service. We do have our business meeting tonight at 6 o'clock. There's the treasurer's reports in the back there, okay, at the end of service. Brother Robbie will be in the back there for the offering and stuff. But I don't want to take too much more time here. I want to, if I could, invite my dear friends. It's so good to have the Abbotts here with us. And we just love these folks. As I said earlier, they have been such a huge blessing in our life over the years. And Jerry, we've known each other. Ms. McNair goes all the way back to Jonathan. Yeah, that's a long time. I asked him earlier, I said, how long have we known each other? And I almost thought he was going to say too long. Thankfully, he did. But anyways, but it's been a long time. And this sweet couple have been faithful to the Lord over the years. And I know they've been through the fire many times in that point, in that ministry. But they love the Lord. They love people. And I'm just so grateful to have them here with us. I'm grateful for the role they've played in my life over the years when I was going through tough times. They were there for me, and I appreciate that very much, more than they'll ever know, but I do appreciate that. So at this time, I'm going to invite Brother Jerry to come and just share with us what he has for us today, what the Lord's laid on his heart, okay?
Thank you, Lord. Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
Morning.
Jumping in there. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Hey,
amen.
Good, good. Well, yeah, we're happy to be here. You know, we love this church. We got some really deep ties in this area as well. And so it's an honor and pleasure to come and share with you guys and kind of bring you some updates and some other things. I want to talk to you today about missions. As you know, my wife and I have been missionaries in Hungary for quite a few years. And then we've been in ministry for over 30 years, I guess, together. So something like that.
Thanks, God.
We'll be having the 49th anniversary, 49th anniversary in December.
Amen.
And again, I want to say that this woman here is, Annette, is fantastic. She's I wouldn't be here. Listen, I'm not just making this up. I would not be here if I had
her. Amen.
So we've had a lot of good times, a lot of bad times, which, you know, everybody has those, right? The one thing is we've always had is each other.
Amen.
But I want to talk to you about missions. That's something very dear to our hearts and maybe your church as well. And so I want to, I'm going to be starting in Luke 24. You can turn there, but I'm going to be jumping around, so I'll give you a verse if you want to look it up. That's great. That's okay too. The title of my message is, Why Should You Be Involved in Missions? When we talk about missions, what exactly are we talking about? For example, let me read Luke 24:46-48 first. Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. Of course, the witnesses were the disciples who were there who saw this. So this is the mandate. This is what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to find those who are unsaved and bring them into the fold of God.
Amen.
In a very simple way of saying. And so these are what God wants. This is what God wants to do. It's our importance of what we need done. There are I don't even know what the population of the world is anymore. I used to know those stats, but it's
7 billion.
7 billion.
Is it 8? Take his word on that.
But how many of those people are actually in a place where there's even an opportunity to hear the gospel? Well, no telling how many places. There's a lot of places where it's hard to say who it is, but how many of us. So we know that, that missions is important. We know as church members that missions is something very important. We don't maybe not always understand all of it, but I think we understand enough to realize that it's so important that it has to be spoken about. That's Amen. What we've been told to do. We know that the pastor says, you know, missions is important. We know that missionaries say, hey, missions is important. But why? Let me give you a definition of missions. Missions is the effort to evangelize and disciple converts by the preaching of the gospel, by baptizing those individuals who follow him in baptism, planting indigenous churches. The word indigenous simply means of the earth, which means that when we went to Hungary, we didn't go to Hungary and ask those people to speak our language and all that. We want them to, you know, their church to be indigenous to where they live and their place. And so, so we want them planting indigenous churches in every nation so that those national converts can reach their own countrymen and reach their world, reach in their neighborhood where they live. And do that for Christ. I mentioned earlier today that we have a little motto. Ethan and I are members at Seminole Baptist Church in Springfield, Missouri. And our kind of our theme is that we want to find and follow. We want people to find and follow Jesus. And those who find and follow Jesus want them to find and follow Jesus. And so this is has to do with those kind of things. We want to realize that missions, some of us, I don't know, if we would ask people, they might be embarrassed, say, what do you think missions is? I wouldn't put anybody on the spot like that. But I want you to say, I can say this, missions is not an elective. It's an essential. Amen. If the church doesn't have missions, it's not 100%, in my opinion, a New Testament church. Okay. But it's not a suggestion. Missions is not a suggestion, it's a command. We just read that command from Luke 4:24. It's not an option. It's an imperative. It's That's something right. that must be done.
Amen.
And it's not a burden. Sometimes I've heard people say, oh, man, I don't know if I want to do this or not. Well, you should.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're going to do what God wants you to do, you're going to have to get in line with what he wants you to do.
Amen.
Now, I'm going to give you some information, some verses there, to talk about why it's important to be involved in this. It doesn't matter, you know, if you give a lot, if you give a little, if you don't give anything at all, but there are different ways to show that you care those around you, and that you can share the gospel with those that you love, and those sometimes you're strangers. You can be in a situation. I can tell you a few stories that I won't be at right now. But anyway. So God is a missionary God. Would you agree with that?
Amen.
I mean, pretty obvious, right? God is a missionary God. The Bible is full from cover to cover about mission statements and examples. In the Old Testament, we see that there is a large part of the Bible has been written to all of mankind, not just the Jewish people. It's for everyone. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah, it makes sense. Abraham made a covenant. God made a covenant with Abraham and reconfirmed that with Isaac and Jacob in Genesis 12:2-3. And I'll just read it to you. It says, I will bless them that bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And so he's saying all nations, that God will bless all nations through the seed of Abraham. So we're all connected. Okay? We're all humans. And so this is just showing us that God is all-inclusive. He's not going to say, well, we don't like those people over there, so just put them over somewhere else. And then do it. God wants everyone to turn to Him. And it's an ultimate choice that we ourselves have to make. It has to be done.
Right.
Now, there's just another little inference here to talk about that it's for everyone, is that the first cross-cultural prayer of intercession is in Genesis 18, where Abraham prays for Sodom and Gomorrah. Actually, he's praying for them to leave Sodom and Gomorrah. But that's a cross-cultural, that simply means one language or culture to another. So when we went from America, we were in one culture. When we went to Hungary, we were in their culture. And we tried to do everything pretty much like they did, as much as we possibly could. Hungarian language is not a very friendly language, especially for a guy who grew up in a Texas accent, but we did the best we could, amen? Also, there's Jeremiah, as described by God as a prophet to the nations, Jeremiah 1:5. In Psalm 67, in verse 2, it says that thy ways may be known upon the earth, and thy saving health among all nations. So again, this we're talking about, this is God's plan, this is plan for us. Psalm 96:3 has a similar sound to it. Declare his glory among the heathen, his wonders among all people. So we should understand that God wants every person that is possible to be exposed to the gospel that Jesus shares through you and me and others. The New Testament example shows that there is Luke, who wrote most of the New Testament, not most of the New Testament, but 52 chapters of the New Testament. So that means that God wants everybody to understand. He wants everybody to hear. Four of the five women that were listed in Matthew, first part of Matthew, are doing the genealogy, which most people just kind of skip over that a little bit. But still, it's interesting that four of five of the women in the lineage of Jesus were non-Jewish.
Right.
Now, we know that there's a special, when we talk about the Jewish people, we know there's a special blend of people. And there's some, something special about them that God has favor for them. Then, the Great Commission, Matthew 28:18-20, I'll read it for you. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. More mission verses, Mark 16:15. This is pretty clear and pretty direct. I think everyone in here can understand this. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. Doesn't mean you have to go to everybody in the world, it just means you need to go to somebody who needs to hear. Luke 24, which is what we started with, tells us that, again, I'll read this, thus it is written, thus it is behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. Aren't you glad he rose on the third day? And that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, giving it to Jerusalem and the witnesses of his sin. It's good to know that sins can be remitted. I am a sinner. And I sin every day, and so do you. But God gives us cleansing. He gives us refreshment. And then there's, my favorite verse in the Bible for most folks is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I lost my place here because of my passport review. Okay, I'm sorry, here it is. What happened in the earlier hour? Who didn't it? You got stuck in
it. I believe in pain, brother.
Okay, John 3:16. For God so loved the world, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever is glad he said he shall. That means I can go and you can. God wants you. And have not prepared to have everlasting life. God is so good.
Amen.
God is just awesome. Missions is very important to the Lutheran and I, and I'm just pretty sure it's important to this congregation. Because without following biblical missions, again, I would have a hard time classifying a congregation as not going to share the gospel. We live in the town of Yazveh, which is a town of about 30,000, I think, approximately, something like that. And the Hungarian language is brutal. I mean, it just beats you out and everything. But somehow we managed to learn enough that we could actually go in and talk to people face to face. And we used translators for a long time, because until you learn the language, you couldn't help us. When you first go to a foreign land, I went to the field. It was the first time we'd been on the field. So whatever, we did a survey trip and came back, and we knew that's what God wanted us. But we realized that it's new, it's something else. And it's hard, and it's very difficult to learn a different language. And like I said maybe earlier, you know, I grew up on cattle ranch in Texas. And so I ended up speaking pretty good Hungarian, but it had a little bit of a Texas accent to it, you know. And I can still understand pretty well, I think. But that town had been there for 700 years. It was started 700 years ago, 7 centuries before the Abbots got there. And the thing is, I've thought about this many times, is that I wondered, what about the people for those 700 years who didn't have a voice? That nobody went there to this town to tell them that God loved them. And I still think of it from time to time. How many generations never heard the gospel? Not even one time. I don't know. Missions is something that is important in a lot of different ways. And I don't know where I got this, but I like it, so I stole it, so I'm going to read it to you. Missions is God's therapy for the sin of selfishness within the local church.
Amen.
Does that make sense? Good there? I'll read it again. Missions is God's therapy for the sin of selfishness within the local church. We have a commander of that. As I read, they're all commands. They're not like, well, if you feel like it, you can't. But no, it has to be this way. There is I've traveling in the past, you know, I've been to different places, and I've had some generous young people that would come up, and they'd say, how'd you get to be a missionary, and why are you a missionary, and ask me some questions like that, which I don't mind that at all. I really enjoy this one with those that are interested. But we don't always do what we're supposed to do. And sometimes we get ourselves in a real jam. I've had young people come up and say, well, what is a call to mission? And you know, that's an interesting question, because to me it might be one thing, to you it could be something totally different, but it's still missions, and it's still reaching people with the gospel. It's not easy. Now, Sometimes people say, well, I have to have a call. I want to have a call. I say, listen. But if you haven't had a call, then you need to call. I can't tell you what God wants you to do. I can't even figure out what I'm supposed to do most of the time. But if you want to know, then you need to pray. You need to get on your knees. You need to talk to your pastor. This is if I'm in somebody else's church. Well, the pastor, good pastor here. But it's important that they understand that it's a God thing. I don't know how to put it. So we have a commandment to that. A call, we're not supposed to wait for a call. Now, I believe when God called me to be a missionary, and my calling and my name would not even be fitting to close to yours, that doesn't mean it's not a valid call. We have a command to obey, and we shouldn't just sit around waiting for God to call us, but we can. Most American Christians, in fact, this is Jim Elliot's, this is a quote from Jim Elliot. If you don't know who that is back in the 40, 50 years ago, Jim Elliot and some others went, Nate Saint and a few others went to the Aka Indians in Ecuador, and they ended up being martyred by the people that they came to share the gospel to and with. And so, but Jim Elliot said this, he said, most American Christians don't need a call to go, they need a kick in the pants.
Amen.
I didn't say it here. So anyway, I like that. Not, I do believe this, not every Christian is called to go to mission field. So if somebody's trying to pressure you, then you shouldn't want to do that. But I would say this, I do think every Christian should struggle with the question, should I go?
Amen.
If we would ask ourselves that question, I know it's a scary question to think about answering, but that's what we need to do. So I just want to let you know that one of the biggest blessings in our lives has been that God has allowed us to go. You know, the angels in heaven, when they're looking into the work of salvation, they don't understand. They'll never understand what it's like. And so the angels don't really, the angels proclaim the good news. But God has chosen angels to proclaim the good news, but he gave us the honor of being the one to share that good news with the person who needs to hear it. God is a missionary God.
Mm-hmm.
And we ought to be thankful that he is, because somebody found me, somebody found you, and so on it goes. There is a hopeless condition of man, and man can only be regenerated if someone brings the good news to that individual so that they can hear it and have an opportunity to say, I appreciate your time, and I thank you for the day, and it's been wonderful to see some new friends, some that we already know, and I appreciate you guys, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Dave. Appreciate that.
Let's stand, shall we?
Prepare for our invitation with your head bowed and your eyes closed. You know, it's amazing that the one thing God left us here, left the church here, left the bride of Christ here for, the one central thing we cannot do once we get to heaven. It's the one thing we can't do when we get to heaven. It's one thing we left us here for. It's often the most forgotten thing. It's sharing our faith. Here at home, where we're not called to go, sending others that will go, at the very least, like Brother Jerry said, being willing, because every Christian should be, I appreciate it, struggle with it in their heart. Say, Lord, is it me? Do you want me to go? Too often we're on the other side of that going, Lord, please don't call me. God, I'm scared. I don't, you know what, the truth be told, and I've never asked Brother Jerry this, Mr. Ruth Mary, but I'll say for myself, when God said, I'm calling you into the ministry, I was scared. Scared to death. There's still times I get scared, plenty of them. But you know what I found about God? When He calls, He always equips and enables. He'll open your door to the Lord's will in your life. He'll step through it. And He'll prove to you that He can do the most amazing things. I wonder this morning, I know what Brother Jerry had to say spoke to me. I trust it spoke to you as well. Say, Pastor, would you pray for me? Because quite honestly, it's easy for me to come to church. It's easy for me to enjoy good teaching, good preaching, good fellowship. But the hard thing is to share my faith. It's hard. And I've got loved ones, I've got friends, I've got family members, I've got co-workers. They need to hear about Jesus Christ. And sometimes it's hard to even be willing to surrender to say, it always is to say, God, I'll go where you want me to go. I'll do what you want me to do. If that means being a missionary, Lord, I'm there wherever you want to send me. I mean, say, Pastor, pray for me today. I want to be open to whatever God wants for me. Share my faith with whoever God puts in my life. Let nobody trips over me get into hell. That what they find when they come across is someone who cares about their soul. Cares about the fact that there is an eternal place called hell. There's also an eternal place called heaven. And the difference is made in a relationship with Jesus Christ. And I want them to know, that there is hope. And I want to be a person that's willing to share that hope with them. Could you raise your hand? Is that you today? I'll be open to that. Thank you for your honesty. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Who else? Thank you. Thank you. How many of you today have someone right now in your mind? You know, we've been down together. We need nothing. Did you slip your hand up? Is that somebody like that on your heart and mind? Thank you for your honesty. Let's pray for them in a second. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it. Hey folks, listen, I know we talked about heaven and hell, and that is the ultimate result. Let's not overstep the fact that when we give our life to Christ, it is a new life in Christ. There is forgiveness, sins past, present, and future. Not because of how good a person you are, but because of how great a God He is. Well, I'm telling you, if I laid out everything that I've done wrong, right here, He'd be here for a couple months, I'm sure. For what I can remember. So thankful for the grace of God. How about you today? Can you say that? Can you say that today? Can you give testimony to the fact that there's been a time in your life when you recognize that you're a sinner? You need a Savior. You didn't play games. It wasn't just mouthing a prayer because maybe the pastor, the youth pastor, or some friend said, hey, listen, repeat after me. And I know we pray, and I know that's that step that we take in showing our faith to the Lord. I realize that. But sometimes I kind of wonder if we just don't repeat something just to get someone off our back. Hey, if you've never given your heart to Christ, that is a step of faith that only you can take. And I'm here to tell you today that He is waiting with arms wide open for you to take that step. For you to give your life to Him. But you've got to take that step. This Holy Spirit speaking to you, my friend. Please don't leave without receiving Him. If that's you today, I want to pray for you. I'm not going to embarrass you. Nobody's going to come pull you out of the aisle. Any of that business. Please don't pray. Is that you today, Pastor? I don't know who's. Would you pray for me? Would you stick your hand up today? I will pray. My prayer is not going to get you into heaven, friend. I'm going to pray you have the courage to do what you want to do. Anybody like that at all? Anybody? Thank you. Father, we bow before you now as we enter this time of invitation. Thank you for the Abbots. Thank you for what you're doing in their life. Lord, be with them, strengthen them for life's journey. Thank you for what you're doing right here at Calvary Baptist. Lord. I pray for the hands uplifted. You know the hearts, you know the people here today that have loved ones, friends, co-workers, family, neighbors, the lost. In Jesus, God, help us to fulfill the Great Commission. Every opportunity, that's why you left us. Help us to do that by supporting missions, by praying for our missionaries, by being willing to go to the mission field, but also looking at our own neighborhood as that mission field too. Lord, please work in our hearts. Pray in Jesus' name. Send us an invitation. I'm going to invite you. If you need someone to pray with, Pastor Randy's up here. I'll be up here later. If you need the Lord as your Savior, don't wait. Come, friend. Something on your heart, friend. It may not be anything that we talk about today. It may be something totally different. We've often said the church is a hospital for the hurting. It's a lighthouse. God leaves here for giving direction, but it's also a hospital for the hurting, a place to find hope, a place to find encouragement. Got something heavy on your heart, friend? Don't come, let's pray with you. Say, can I take care of it right where I'm at? Absolutely. Awesome. God said, hey, listen, I want you to pray with someone about this. Where two or more are gathered in my name, where two or more will agree on anything, we put God's in the middle of that. Would you do that right now? I'm going to ask these ladies to sing through another verse of invitation. Would you girls mind doing that? God's spoken to you. Pray. God's people said, amen. Thank you. Maybe see what this time. I'm going to ask Pastor Randy or David, would you come forward? And if I can have it happen, come up. We'd like to do this. Missionaries and these sweet folks are just a blessing, have been a blessing to many of us. And if you're just now getting to know them, I hope we'll take time to say hello to them and with you guys, if that be okay. And this sweet couple, I know, and I won't get into everything, but they've been through the fire. And just because you're in the ministry, I think sometimes people think it means you're bored. And boy, I wish that were true, but it's not. And so Paul, I think about what he said and the things that he went through and endured. That stuff still happens. Okay? In other ways, but it still happens. And so we'd like to pray with you guys if you'd allow us that, as the church body would, to pray with us. Okay? Brother Randy, would you start us for the day, and then I'll finish up.
Gracious Heavenly Father, you are God. Lord, it is just amazing how you take individuals, people, and you do amazing works in your name, in us and through us. Lord, you change the world by changing hearts, by changing feelings. Father, we thank you for this amazing couple. We thank you, Lord, for the perseverance and the endurance that you have shown us through them. Lord, we thank you for the lives that have changed in their own home and well beyond, in this country and in others. The lives that they have changed and helping people to see the need to be able to answer the call and to go and to let Christ's light shine in this world, this dark world, where other people may not ever get to see it if it weren't for others that were willing to obey. Starting with this amazing Father, as they've gone through these, they've walked through fire, they've walked through many things in life, Lord, and they, like the Apostle Paul, have been embattled, and they have scars to show and to prove that, Lord, you've been with them every single step, and you continue to be so. Lord, as we are so grateful and thankful for their shown faithfulness, we thank you for your faithfulness to them and through them. Father, we ask you to continue blessing upon them and their family and their ministry as they move forward in the name. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Father, we thank you. We're so grateful for just being in the house today, Lord, here, a small part of what you're doing for Brother Bill and Sister Mary, Lord. Lord, we thank you for this privilege and opportunity. Lord, we pray together that you continue to strengthen and encourage you, Lord, and your office with you, Lord. And Father, we do thank you for in sharing what you're doing through them. And Lord, we just we ask that you would open doors, Lord, from that prayer. Be back in the mission field where they desire to be, Lord. Send people, Lord, come to you. Such a powerful thing, Lord. We just ask that you open those doors again, Lord. That folks would come to know you through Brother Jerry and Sister Mary, Lord. We thank you for them. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to encourage them and strengthen them. This ministry, then, Lord, is only you can. And Lord, we've heard that that's a very trying times, and Lord, we just pray for them. We just hope that they'll be able to do them again. Continue, Lord, to bless in mighty and powerful ways, and you can. Precious name of Jesus.
Heavenly Father, as we continue to bow before you and to lift up this sweet family, Lord, we thank you for them. I thank you for them, God, personally, for their friendship and what's meant to us over the years. And I thank you, God, for their willingness to be there for me and for many others, Lord. Countless others, God. They may never even know about the lives they've touched until they get to heaven, but God, we thank you for their faithfulness. And Lord, we lift them up to you, because we know that there's nobody in this room that cares more about them than you, God. Lord, we pray that you would be with them, comfort, guide, direct them. Lord, bless them. Help them, Father, when days seem dark to see the sunshine. Help them, God, that along life's journey that you would protect them as you continue to use them. Father, I know they've been through the fire.
We lift that up to you right now. Continue to mend the hurt and the hearts, Lord, and continue to work in their lives to help them, Lord, in whatever way they need. Father, let them know that they always have friends right here who care about them and who love them. And Father, I'm just asking for you to put your hedge of protection about them and their family, to love on them, Father, to let them go and continue on in their life, Lord, with your great amount of grace that you give each one of us when we need it. We love you, Lord. We thank you for this sweet comfort. We praise you for it. In Jesus' name, we thank you for it. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Let's stand, shall we? We're going to give these folks the right hand of fellowship. Yes, sir.
Let's not stand just yet. Everybody sit back there.
We just stopped.
We're Baptists. It's not even noon yet. We've got to let the Methodists get the cafeteria first. So we got a little something to show you. It's all Robin's fault.
I want to thank you for being a great friend, a great mentor, and a great pastor. You've been so kind to us all, and we love you. We thank you for everything.
We love you!
Hello, Pastor Wes. I want to know, I appreciate you and your family, and I just love this church, and I just thank you for being there, and showing the support, and I love you, and thank you.
Wes, I appreciate you letting my family be involved.
Thank you, Pastor Wes, for deciding to do this trip.
Good morning, Brother Wes. So happy that you're our new pastor for us, like it's our family. And we appreciate all the times you've got this church. Pastor Wes and Rebecca, I want to say thank you very much for your continued desire to serve us as your church family. And we appreciate you more than you could ever know. And I hope that you enjoy us as much as we enjoy you. Hey, Pastor Wes, you appreciate all that you do. Love you and your family.
Pastor Wes, we really appreciate everything you do here. They're making me say this. They gave me $40.
Hey, Wes, we love you as a pastor. We appreciate you and your family and all that you do. And I, for one, am very proud to be part of my pastor.
Well, Pastor Wes, I wish you the best. And I think that you're a great pastor. And I'm so happy to be a member of the church here. And you've been there for me through all the good times and tough times, and you've been a great friend, and love you and family.
Hey, Brother Wes, I just want to say that I really want to thank you for the work that you do for the Lord and sermons that you did and those up on my toes. And that you did not run off the first time you went up to the house, and I was in the stuff you paid for you. Coming around, so. And I just, again, I'm so thankful for your family and for your loving you.
Wes, we just want to let you know how much we appreciate you. We do love you. I'm trying to
hey, hey, Pastor, we just want to let you know how much we appreciate you and love serving with you. And, just appreciate you for thanking us so much.
Pastor Wes, I just want to know that I appreciate you so much for me to my boys. Whether it's my Jonathan at 14 or my Ben at 36, you have been a fantastic leader and encouragement to me. Your family has. But thank you for your sweet spirit and just running your congregation there.
Serving with us here and being our pastor and all have a big speech here, but tell us how much we love you. But we've got a small token of our appreciation. Brother Manny, to get up here. Sorry about that. Both these men. I hope you guys realize where we're at and what God is doing for these two wonderful men here and what the outlook is for this area, this community, and what God is willing and wanting to do through not only them, but each and every one of us who are part of this community and see it grow and the possibilities are unlimited for our Lord. And we thank you very much. God bless you all. A small person.
I want this church to know how much you guys mean to us. We love you. I'm so thankful to be here. And I'll just speak for myself and my wife. This church breathed new wind into my sails. And because I didn't always know, you know what, I would be in the ministry for continued time. You guys have just loved on us, and we love you back. I just want you to know that. We pray for you, and we're so grateful to be here with you and be with us. Thank you. So I want to know, were our wives in on this? Because both of them are absent this morning. Most of the time the wives come up with the pastors, and the pastor, if we receive a gift, we quickly, what do? We hand it to our wives. So it's a little awkward not having them here this morning.
Jake's a great afternoon.
That would be about right. But anyway, God is so good. And he has manifested that by giving you all to us. And our family of six, it's difficult to find a church home where all six of us are truly welcome and appreciated. It has proven to be very difficult through the years. And I will say that this church has done just that. It is a place where we feel very welcome, very safe, and a place to be open, which makes it very, very easy to want to open up ourselves and want to grow with you. And God is good, and I thank him. Thank you. Appreciate you very, very much, Brother Randy. Let's stand, shall we? Brother Rudy.